So thanks a lot for joining this webinar. Today we are going to talk about alternative IDs and explain you how it works and how to leverage them for your advertising strategy. So I am Marine de Sauter. I am the product marketing lead for the demand side of the business at Smart. I'm happy to present this session together with Benoît Cafol, who is our head of product on the supply side, and with Lucie Laurendon, who is my counterpart on the supply side. So today, yes, we are going to talk about alternative IDs. We have four main focus to explain you in detail what are the alternative IDs. So the first one is to give you an introduction, an overview of those alternative IDs. What is it? How it works? Who is providing them? And so on. Then we will share with you some figures and some trends that we are able to extract from our inventory as we are an SSP. And then we will go on the publisher side and on the buyer side to really explain to you how you can leverage and make the most of those alternative IDs. So before we start, just practical information. So all the microphones and cameras are turned off. We'll have a Q&A session at the end. So if you have questions, feel free to add them in the Q&A box that you should have on the right part of your screen, and we will be happy to answer them at the end of the webinar. Okay, so let's talk about the context to start with. So we'll start with this timeline. I guess you already know it if you are part of our ecosystem, but it's always a good reminder. So as you can see on the top of the screen, we have GDPR and the CCPA laws that are really the regulations that are impacting our ecosystem. And the different browsers and OS in our ecosystem are taking some measure to go beyond in terms of user privacy. So what we can see is that Safari and Firefox are already in a working mode where they prevent the usage of third-party cookies for advertising strategies. And the big milestone that we all have in mind is 2022 with Chrome, who has decided to make the third-party cookies disappear as well. And we also have this side topic with Apple that is now limiting the access to IDFA on the Apple iOS 14. So this means that we have two main topics to have in mind for the future. It is the non-consent and the cookie-less traffic. And we, as marketer and publisher, need to take that into consideration in our strategy. So what is the impact for the value chain of the disparition of third-party cookies? Mainly three: the audience targeting, the attribution and measurement, and all the advertising optimization, and for example, the frequency capping. All of those strategies are based on third-party cookies, and well, today, and without user identification, they can't be applied properly. So the objective for everyone in the industry is to be able to keep doing those strategies with alternative solutions. So how does the industry move forward? So there is two main approach. The first one is to keep working with user ID-based strategies. And here are two examples: alternative IDs and first-party data. And on the other side, the option is to work with no ID strategies. And we have two main approaches there, which are cohort-based strategy, which is one of the strategy that is mainly pushed by Google, and the contextual part, which is also a way to work without any ID in the targeting strategies. So today we are going to go deeply in the alternative ID strategies. And I will let the mic to Benoit to go into the details.
Yes, thank you, Marine. Hi, everyone. So, yeah, I will introduce you a bit more details about what are alternative IDs and how could they be used by publishers and buyers. But let's start with a simple definition. So alternative IDs aim to replace third-party cookies. So it's, as Marine mentioned, a replacement of third-party cookies. And this works by using a same shared ID across the whole advertising chain. So this means that all the parties involved in the monetization chain will use and share the same ID. To show this more in a like visual way and compare the today's world with the tomorrow's world with alternative IDs. So today, advertising operates each players on the monetization chain works with his own ID. So the publisher has his own ID, the SSP works with his IDs, the DSP, same, the DMP has his own ID, and all those IDs are stored in the third-party cookies and are synced together through a cookie synchronization mechanism. But in the end, everyone works with his own ID. Alternative IDs will change the situation by having everyone working with a shared and common ID, which should be the one used by every player, so SSP, DSPs, and the others. And these IDs will be stored in a first-party cookie, and so which is important to differentiate the cookie and the ID that is used. In today's world, everyone works with his own ID stored in a third-party cookies. With alternative IDs, everyone will work with the same ID stored in a first-party cookie. And this makes it the good alternative for browsers that block third-party cookies as those IDs will still be supported by browsers. So in terms of naming, you may hear different names for alternative IDs. So we've chosen the alternative ID name, but you can hear about universal IDs, which also encompass this idea of having one universal ID for the whole ecosystem. But we can also hear about shared ID, extended ID, which is more like the technical name used in the OpenRTB standard. External IDs, also some are calling it ID graphs because sometimes these IDs could be used to graph users across multiple domains. And sometimes they are named first party IDs, which is probably a bit over named given the structure and the, yeah, the name, the way alternative IDs work. So today, that's why it's sometimes hard to call them universal because there are like more than 20 different IDs that want to position as alternative IDs in the market. And they are operated by different players. So there are pure players for ID technologies like ID5, Brightpool. Data providers themselves have created sometimes their own alternative IDs to work without third-party cookies, like LiveRamp, Zeotap, or Lotame. Some DSPs have also created their own ID, especially Criteo, but also the Trade Desk with the unified ID. And other players like tech providers, single sign-on solution, measurement company are also have created their own alternative ID. So it's important to differentiate two ways to operate alternative IDs. And when I mean operate is how the user will be identified. The first methodology is called inferred or probabilistic, and it consists in using passive signals information from the user to apply an ID to this user. So these signals could be like an IP address, the user agent, the browser used by the user, which combined together will make this signal unique and will enable these IDs providers to apply a pseudonymous identifier to the user. This methodology is used by Lotame and ID5, for example. On the other side, there is deterministic IDs, which instead of using passive signals, will use active signals provided by the user. So the user will provide some piece of information like his email address, a phone number. Some information could be used as unique information to identify the user. And the ID providers will convert this piece of information into an anonymized identifier. So this technology is used, for example, by the Trade Desk in the Unified ID or LiveRamp. Each of these methodologies have different benefits and drawbacks. The probabilistic approach is great for reach because basically any users can be covered by an alternative ID as it's only based on passive signals, so the user doesn't need to provide any information to be identified. On the opposite of the deterministic approach, where the user needs to provide some piece of information, so the reach will be reduced because not all the users will provide their email or phone number. But on the other side, the value is different because the probabilistic approach is based on passive signals. Sometimes you may identify wrongly two different users, and so two users with the same signals could be identified as one. So it's less accurate than deterministic, where the user is identified with a personal piece of information. And so the value is much higher because it's guaranteed that this ID will be unique, but also because sometimes and most of the time is based on email, this ID can serve to map some online information with offline information. If the brand is able to have access to the user email from a loyalty program or an e-commerce website, for example, you can track the user from the ad to the conversion. And so this makes this ID much more valuable, but again, with a lower reach. So how does it work in practice? So a user will visit a publisher page. Then the publisher will integrate an ID or multiple ID provider solution directly or via their bidding wrapper to retrieve an anonymous identifier. So at this step, it's here that depending on the methodology used by the ID provider, that either the ID provider will use passive signals like IP address or user agent or user provided information like email address to return an anonymous identifier. So all this information will always be converted in an anonymous ID that will be stored in the publisher first party cookie or local storage. Then this ID will be sent to the ad server and the SSP in the ad call. The ad server and the SSP will forward this identifier in the bid request to the DSP. Both the ad server and the SSP can use this identifier to take advertising decisions, so for example, frequency capping or audience segment matching. And at the end of the funnel, the advertiser will also be able to identify the same user using the same ID provider technology. So on the advertiser website, the user will also be able to be identified the same way as on the publisher website. And the measurement will also could be based on the same identifier, and the measurement of the conversion and the attribution will be based on the same identifier. So just to highlight the key difference between alternative IDs and other alternative solutions to cookie to the end of third-party cookies. So third-party cookies covers all the use case of the advertising. First-party IDs that could be used also, or like publisher first-party ID are able to replace some of the use case, but for example, they are not able to be used for attribution measurements as compared to alternative IDs that are able to cover all the use case with the difference between reach and precision. Contextual targeting won't be able to cover frequency capping or attribution, and cohort-based targeting will also be could be used to partly cover this use case, but with some constraints in terms of reach and precision. So more practically, if you want to start working with an alternative ID or multiple alternative IDs, so if you are a publisher, you need to implement one or several ID provider solutions on your websites. So this can be done in two steps. First, you need to register with some ID providers. So this is not a requirement. So some will require you to register like LiveRamp ID5 or Zeotap. And this registration could be also sometimes be done online. So you don't necessarily need to be in contact with someone, but at least sign up to use these IDs. Some other ID providers do not require any sign up like QTO or the pre-bid shared ID. And the second step is to integrate this ID provider script into your website, either through your header bidding connection, or if you can also directly integrate the provider script or use an identity hub like the one that Smarts provide, and we will explain it a bit more later. On the demand side, you do not need to do anything to work with alternative IDs because the DSP will be the one in charge of integrating the alternative IDs. So it will be transparent for the buyers. And so most of the time, you won't know that if your DSP supports alternative IDs or use different approach to identify users. One thing to keep in mind is in terms of business model, alternative IDs are most of the time free for publishers and buyers. And the business model of ID providers are either to charge the ad tech provider to use an alternative ID, or they use this ID to run another business, like a data business, in the case of LiveRamp or Zeotap.
So thank you, Benoit. So now let's speak about the figures. So we'll go into the trends and the data that we are able to collect as an SSP. So to start with, I want to mention that we started our identity indicator. It's a quarterly report where we provide the market with some key metrics across 8 markets about consent and identity. So there is a link here that we will put also in the chat. But it's something very interesting for you to understand the coverage of third-party cookies, the coverage of alternative ID, and many other information related to a future without cookie. So if we look into some details of this report, first we can have a look at the share of ad inventory from browsers already limiting third-party cookies. So as you can see here in white, this is the share of auctions coming from browser, so Safari and Firefox, that are already limiting third-party cookies. So we can see that in Germany, where Firefox has a strong coverage, this ratio is already almost one third of the business. But it's also quite significant in other markets, but still variable from one country to another. If we go to the next slide, we can see the trend as well on mobile browser. And the ranking, as you can observe, is quite different. This is mainly due to the iPhone coverage in the USA and in the UK, who are mainly on Safari, which is a browser which is already limiting the access to third-party cookies. Whereas what you can see in yellow, it's mainly Chrome with Android. So outside of the browser, what is interesting is to look at the share of ad inventory that has absolutely no user identifiers. So it can be because of the browsers, as we saw previously, but it's also because of consent. When there is no consent, we are not able to forward the personal identifier in the bid request. So it means that we have an increasing number of pull requests that have absolutely no user ID. So no cookie, no mobile ID, or no other user ID are sent in the build request. And this is particularly true in Germany, where almost half of the inventory doesn't have identifiers anymore. So this figure is very important. And as you can imagine, as a marketer and as a publisher, it's important to see the opportunity that already exists to target inventory without those user ID, where the competition on the impression is less important. If we go to the next slide, here we are focusing particularly on alternative IDs. And what we can see on the top of the screen is that in many countries, the coverage is already quite big. So this is a view on header bidding inventory that we collect at Smart. And it's a mix of all the providers we are currently supporting. But you can see that we already have 40% of the inventory in the USA, in the UK, that provide an alternative ID, which means that there is an opportunity and a high trend to start testing strategies around those alternative ID. We can also see that the coverage is very different from one market to another. And for example, in Spain, we only have 5% of alternative ID coverage, which means that this market is less mature in that field. So yes, I will now let the mic to Lucie to talk about the supply side.
Thank you, Marine. Hi everyone. So now we will focus on the publisher side and let you know how to work with alternative IDs with Smart. First of all, since day one, Smart's objective is really to help publishers navigate the new alternative IDs topic and help them transition as smoothly as possible. So Smart enables publishers to easily work with any ID providers. This means that we are ID provider agnostic. We are supporting all IDs of the market. How do we enable that for our customers? So we are ID provider agnostic. Whatever is your integration type with Smart, client-side data bidding, ad serving or manage holistic plus, you will be able to integrate alternative IDs. For now, we do not support alternative IDs for publishers plugged with us through server-side bidding. And we support on all environments except in-app and AMP. We also provide a self-serve ID management UI that is called Identity Hub, and we will make a focus on this one just right after to facilitate the wall management of your alternative IDs. And finally, we provide some analytics and insight regarding alternative adoption in your inventory within our internal reporting tools. So how Smart supports alternative IDs. Here are the three use cases that we are covering with alternative IDs. First of all, as mentioned by Benoit, we will forward all alternative IDs, if the publisher integrated it, in the bid request to the DSP. And the DSP has also have to be compatible with these alternative IDs. Marine will talk about that in a few minutes. Second, if your DMP supports alternative IDs, you can match your audience segments with Smart and target users on direct or programmatic campaigns. The last use case we will be able to cover in June is frequency capping. So publishers will be able to run direct and programmatic campaigns with frequency capping based on alternative IDs. And now focus on our Smart Identity Hub. That is really, the goal is really to help publishers easily manage your ID providers and all your alternative IDs. So that's a self-serve UI for some of our publishers, the ones that are using our Manage Holistic Plus offer. That's an end-to-end solution to easily access the configuration of the user ID module from Prezi.js. Thanks to that, you will be able to activate and deactivate your ID providers without changing anything in your page, really simply on your interface, on and off. We will support more than 20 ID providers that are available on Prezi.js. And once configured and deployed on the page, Smart.js will automatically catch the IDs returned by the providers to enrich the call sent to Smart and then to the DSP in the bid request. So both bidders and Smart will benefit from these IDs. So do not hesitate to check our identity hub. So publishers, how you should move forward with alternative IDs and right now, even if the coverage is not yet here and even we still have third-party cookies. First of all, you should start contacting ID providers. As Benoit mentioned, it's completely free and our recommendation is to integrate with Criteo, ID5, the Trade Desk and LiveRoom. That's the one that have the most coverage on the market, and Criteo is the easiest one to integrate right now as you do not have to register with them. All the links are available in the Smart documentation. So for our Smart publishers, you can check them. Second, integrate. Once you have the go from ID providers, you can integrate ID providers depending on your setups. Do not hesitate to contact your sales representative at Smart so that they can help you integrate with these ID providers depending on your setup. For Manage Holistic Plus customers, as mentioned, as you're going to have Identity Hub, at a minimum, switch on Criteo ID as no registration is required and it's already in your UI. Third, as we mentioned, you can start onboarding your first party data on alternative IDs and then if your DMP supports it, start matching the segments with Smart so that you can use it to onboard your first party data and recover rich on browser blocking third party cookie. And last, please provide feedback to our sales team so that we can, if you have any questions, concerns, or issues.
Thank you, Lucy. So we'll make a focus as well on the demand side. So how can you buy and how can you use those alternative IDs if you are programmatic buyers? So first, we already saw partly this information with Benoit earlier in the presentation, but keep in mind that alternative IDs enable you to operate your campaign the same way as you do with cookies. So this is the main benefits of alternative IDs compared to other cookie-less approach. It's really the way to do things the same way and have the same use cases covered. So how do you activate those IDs? So for capping and targeting, it is done by the DSP automatically. So they will select the proper ID directly and you have nothing to do on your end if your DSP is supporting the ID, the ID providers, of course. If you are looking to use alternative ID to activate your first party data or for measurement, you will have to do a setup on your side to match your data with those alternative ID. So how do we support alternative ID for buyers? So we forward the IDs in the bid request to the DSP. We are ID agnostic, so same information as we share with the supply. Smart supports alternative ID in any type of environments. And important to know, as a buyer, you need to work with a DSP which is supporting alternative IDs. And if not, you can still activate those ID by buying, for example, from Smart SSP via a deal ID. So in any case, you are able to leverage those IDs with Smart, whatever your DSP. So this is the end of the presentation. So we have three takeaways. The first one is, so alternative ID are one of the main options to work around the deprecation of third-party cookies. And as we said, this is really the best way to operate the same way as with third-party cookies. The second takeaway is that we are agnostic and we are enabling you to operate with any ID providers. And the last is to start testing now. So as you saw in the figures, the coverage is already there, especially in some markets like US, UK, or France. So there is some volume, and we think that it's the right moment to start testing. You could start testing on Safari and Firefox, which are environments where cookies are not available anymore. So it's a nice way to really start understanding and leveraging those ID alternatives in your campaign strategies. So that's it for the presentation. So now, if you have questions, we will be very happy to answer them, whether it's about the product part, some tech questions, or some more figure-related questions. This is really up to you.
Marine, we have a first question.
Okay. So the question is, do we support LiveRamp ID? So I will let Benoit answer this one.
Yeah, so the answer is yes, we support LiveRamp ID. So it's the if the publisher has integrated with LiveRamp script, we are able to pass the LiveRamp ID to DSPs that support the LiveRamp ID.
Okay, thank you, Benoit. We do not have other questions for now. So I guess we are good. So thank you for your attention. Don't hesitate
maybe
to get back.
So, yeah. Sorry yes. to interrupt, but maybe we can put in the chat the link of the indicator so that people can
yes.
download it.
Yes, yes. I will do it now. Very good point.
Let time to for people who want to ask the last question if they want to.
Okay, so it's in the chat now. So thank you, everybody. We will wrap up this session, and we will send the recording to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.